Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly? The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 7522 in the name of Rona Mackay on the cost to families of imprisonment and release. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Rona Mackay to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The cost of living crisis is affecting everyone in some way or another. But for those with a loved one in prison, it's a crisis that's disproportionately damaging. We know that when someone is sentenced to a prison term, the adverse ripple effect on families is immense. A cost of living crisis coming on the back of a decade of austerity and the COVID pandemic is really taking its toll. The impact of that harsh reality is highlighted in a new report from Families Outside, an excellent third sector organisation that has been supporting families of prisoners in Scotland for many years. The report's called Paying the Price, the Cost to Families of Imprisonment and Release, and it sets out starkly the situation families now find themselves in. The consultant to the report, Dr. Breege Nugent, and the superb team at Families Outside, led by Professor Nancy Laux, highlighted that one in six UK households, that's 4.4 million approximately, is now in serious financial difficulties. As convener of the cross-party group on Women, Families and Justice, can I take this opportunity to thank all the stakeholders who attend the group regularly. We're very fortunate in Scotland to have such a stellar third sector network of organisations and professionals concerned with the welfare of families and children affected by imprisonment. Presiding Officer, the report reveals that 27% of children are living in poverty, and in areas such as Glasgow, this rises to one in three. Single parents, predominantly women on low incomes, have been especially affected, and the worries parents face about putting food on the table and paying bills is described in the report as a toxic brew, having an adverse impact on mental health. For the report, which was funded by ABRDN Financial Fairness Trust, Families Outside were able to hear directly from families affected by imprisonment to understand the impact this was having. So there are currently approximately 7,400 people in prison, 96% of whom are male, 280 of whom are women, 100 of those women are on remand, and most have 102 of those women are on remand, and most have children. For families with those on remand, it was an especially uncertain, stressful, and costly time. Remember, these are people who have not been convicted of any crime. Scotland has one of the highest remand populations in Europe, with nearly 30% of all people in prison held on remand. The Bail and Release Bill, currently proceeding through Parliament, will hopefully alleviate that, but there's no doubt remand is an especially costly and stressful time for families, with £300 per month on average spent providing support. And for some, it rose to £1,000. And the cost for families with those who had been sentenced, the costs are also stark. For someone who'd served 6 years in prison, the median total spent on calls, travelling and visiting per month was £180 a month. That's £2,160 a year supporting the person in prison. Alison, a kinship carer in her 60s, is supporting her daughter who's in prison on a short sentence. She said, "I can't keep doing this. The stress is around us all the time. I have all the responsibility and it's wearing me down. It's affected my mental and physical health." Presiding Officer, the first 2 months after the person is out of prison are the most stressful and costly, as the person is often without any money until their benefit claims are set up, housing arrangements are made, and they have no money needed simply to exist post-prison. As is almost always the case, women are left to, quote, cope when a family member is in prison or has been released. And they do that by careful management of their already pressured budgets, by skipping meals, not buying clothes or visiting food banks. They stop socialising or engaging in activities that cost money, leading them to have a diminished lifestyle, which in turn affects their mental health. Of course, rising energy costs were of particular concern, adding to the stress of eking out the family budget. Children miss out on activities, and many interviewed said the concept of family time no longer existed as it had done before. There's no doubt the Scottish Government's £25 per child benefit, not available anywhere else in the UK, will be a lifeline to many families at this time. and many prisons have now introduced excellent family units and early learning practitioners to help with family contact. So what more can be done? Families outside who offer such amazing practical and emotional support to families have suggested many common sense recommendations, and I only have time to mention a few. They ask for a removal of charges for electronic payments made into prison accounts, to allow families to hand in items rather than post them, maintain free access to video calls, maintain free allocation of minutes for phone calls, provide free basic hygiene products and packs in prison, and to reduce the cost of food available in visitor centres, which is often way too high. Access to funds must be improved, and financial support for families, such as benefits, claims and travel passes, should be available immediately upon release from prison to help that prisoner back into society. People should always be placed in prisons close to their homes, and a requirement for an assessment of the potential impact of family contact before a person is transferred to another prison. Finally, reducing the stigma families affected by imprisonment face in society, there's a number of ways that can be done, such as removing the use of the HMP prison stamps on posts received from establishments, and implement measures to promote education and equalities, for example, training on the impact of imprisonment, reference to the impact of imprisonment as part of PSE classes in school. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we must provide alternatives to prison, particularly for women. Many women who are incarcerated are victims of domestic abuse, have addiction and mental health issues. We have the evidence. Prison wrecks families. It creates, sustains and deepens poverty amongst children and families. They are guilty of no crime, and we must do everything we can to support them. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Sandesh Gohani. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Rona Mackay for holding this debate today, and I welcome the findings of Families Outside's report on the cost to families of imprisonment and release. The debate is an incredibly important one, as those costs can be devastating for families. We need to acknowledge the concerns that prison has a role in creating, sustaining and deepening poverty amongst children and families, as well as the emotional impacts. There is a shocking statistic: around 27,000 children in Scotland are affected by a parent's imprisonment. That is more than those affected by divorce. We must acknowledge the issue of remand. Scotland has a large remand population, and in the majority of cases, people are later released. We need to consider reforming this system while protecting public safety to ensure that families aren't affected by that shock of someone ending up in prison temporarily before being acquitted. This is one reason why the Scottish Government's Bail and Release Bill is much needed, and I look forward to seeing it progress. The report from Families Outside states that the families of people held in prison overwhelmingly live on very low incomes, often below the minimum income standard. At the same time as bearing the loss of an average household monthly income of £890, some families find themselves spending a considerable proportion of their disposable income on supporting loved ones in prison. This has been made worse by families by a decade of Tory austerity, which has now been exacerbated by the cost of living crisis. On release, the costs of support do not fall, with the Families Outside report highlighting that families face average costs of £300 a month in the first months after release. Rona Mackay's motion calls for more support for people leaving prison, which in turn would help their families. Research indicates that better mainstream opportunities, employment after release, reduces the likeliness of reoffending. There is some good work being carried out in this regard. I recently visited a Timpson store in East Kilbride and was pleased to learn about their charity, the Timpson Foundation. We all know Timpson is a business that fixes our shoes and cuts our keys, but the Foundation's work could offer a blueprint for industry to offer those opportunities to people. The Timpson Foundation specialises in the recruitment of marginalised groups within society including those who have been in prison. Approximately 10% of their 6,500 employees are made up of people who have criminal convictions, with a staff retention rate of around 75%. By choosing not to judge people by their past, treating their recruits and employees with respect, and by offering them autonomy through training and employment, Timpson is actively addressing the stigma faced by people who have spent time in prison. But the Timpson Foundation goes further than simply employing people who have been in prison. They have invested in a number of training academies situated in prisons across the UK. And they also train prisoners on release on temporary licence programmes, helping people into employment after leaving prison. To sum up, Presiding Officer, I would be interested to know whether the Scottish Government can support businesses and the public sector to follow the Timpson Foundation's lead. And importantly, I thank Families Outside for the work that they do supporting families affected by imprisonment, as well as carrying out important research, such as the findings that we are talking about today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. I now call Sandish Gohani to be followed by Michael Marr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Dr Gohani.
Thank you, and I'm grateful to Rona Mackay for bringing this debate. Scotland has a prison population of around 7,500, with around 25% of prisoners on remand. And many prisoners have families in our communities, partners, children, elderly relatives. And in committing their crimes, they've knowingly put their own loved ones at risk. There's financial hardship, stigma, mental burden. And these financial pressures are happening at a time of continent-wide economic downturn, a global energy crisis, and a war raging in Central Europe that threatens to overspill. In recent years, our courts have seen a marked increase in common assault, rape, and attempted rape, as well as threatening or abusive behaviour. In fact, Scottish Government stats find the number of people in prison for sexual offences has doubled over the last decade, and the proportion of the prison population held in remand has also increased substantially. Our criminal justice system incarcerates people in order to protect the public at large, sometimes by breaking up crime syndicates. Removing perpetrators from society is also punishment, while prison also provides support for rehabilitation, which is important to reduce reoffending. Rehabilitation stands a much better chance of success if we are strict about eradicating drugs from the prison estate and we strengthen mental health support. It's estimated that 15% of Scotland's prison population has a long-term mental health condition, with 17% having a history of self-harm. And while the Scottish Prisoner Survey found 39% of those convicted had used illegal drugs at some point while in prison, we can't let up on mental health support, and this should also be provided to our huge remand prisoner population, who are not entitled to quite the same meaningful activity as convicted prisoners. My colleague Jamie Green has been very vocal on this problem and of self-harm and suicide of prisoners on remand. For partners and children separated from offending family members, their mental health is often so stretched to the limit, particularly the mental health of children, and this cannot be swept under the carpet. Yet we know that the Scottish Government has failed to tackle countrywide backlogs in mental health support, just as it's failed to tackle our country's mounting drug and alcohol deaths. Teenagers in Scotland refer to child and adolescent mental health services with eating disorders, suspected ADHD or autism, are being told to expect a two-year wait for CAMHS appointments, and parents with savings are being asked to go privately at a cost of around £1,500 for assessment. This is simply not an option for many families, especially those of prisoners. And as for prisoners and their families who suffer with addictions, our Right to Recovery Bill should be at the heart of a health-led approach to combating addiction, which is so often the source of offending. The Scottish Prisoner Survey has found 45% of prisoners reported being under the influence of drugs at the time of their offence, while 40% said they were drunk. Everybody who seeks treatment for addiction should be able to access a preferred treatment option unless it's deemed harmful by a medical professional. Now, the focus of today's members' motion is on prisoners and their family, but there is one glaring omission: the victims of crime and their families. Victims also suffer financial stress as a result of theft, higher insurance premiums, loss of paid work. They experience anxiety, loss of confidence. Many are victims of sexual or physical violence. Some victims feel forced to move away, change jobs. Others simply don't have that option. And families affected by the imprisonment of criminals should be treated with fairness so they can be supported to live healthy lives, free from stigma. And this should also apply to families of prisoners and also families of victims. Over the coming 3 weeks, I'm looking forward to hearing from SNP leadership candidates on how they intend to reverse an alarming increase in sexual assault and violent crime, and for once start to emphasise the right of victims and their plans to support all families impacted by offenders.
Thank you, Dr. Gahani. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The report from Families Outside rightly highlights the extraordinary strain the imprisonment of a family member places on some of our poorest families in Scotland. And all of those strains are greatly amplified, as previous speakers have pointed out, by the current cost of living crisis, where any flexibility in income has been greatly reduced. And it's right that Parliament considers these impacts. As such, I thank the member for bringing the motion tonight. The report highlights the importance of the immediate post-release period and found that all too often the burden of support fell solely on families who have already endured so much during the period of imprisonment, and the amount of resource that is highlighted that is spent by families, a huge amount of any income that they have to support prisoners when they are inside, members of their own families. But there is an urgent need for quality through care support for people leaving prison and their wider families to best ensure people do not return to prison and that the cycle of poverty is not further entrenched. So quality through care support is especially needed for those struggling with substance misuse, and my remarks this evening will focus on that pressing issue. In 2019, the Dundee Drug Commission report raised the challenges posed to accessing good quality treatment both pre and post release. In July 2022, the National Drugs Death Task Force report recommended 9 actions relating to prisons. One such action calls on the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service to establish an integrated case management approach so that the individual receives support from before sentencing right through until after they are released from prison. That work is directly complementary to the conclusions of the report we're here to discuss tonight. So I would appreciate if the Minister, in summing up, could give an update on that vital work. Whenever we allow a newly released prisoner to emerge to chaos, to poverty, to hunger, we greatly increase the chances that they will soon be back in prison, or, as in far too many cases, that their life can be lost within mere days of parole. And we can ask then, what was the purpose of all of this? The report was clear that the first 2 months after leaving prison are especially challenging, particularly with regard to finances. And I find the report particularly insightful and illuminating concerning the fact that our devolved system of welfare was meant to allow for payments to be scheduled for release, but in practice, this almost never happens. The door opens to poverty and the path leads back to crime. More must be done to allow those released from prison to reintegrate into society, to find work, to prevent the cycle of poverty and feelings of despair that can lead to further substance misuse. The cost of government inaction in all of this is counted out in lives lost and weighed out in the pain of loved ones who are left behind. According to the National Drug-Related Deaths Database report in 2017, 10% of all drug-related deaths in Scotland were of people who had been released from prison in the last 6 months. In 2018, the figure was 9.7%. Data for the subsequent years has not yet been published, something that I find to be entirely unacceptable. And I do struggle, continue to struggle, to see how any policy approach can be properly assessed when we wait 5 years for data as to who lives or dies. So we can only speculate on the impact of the pandemic and the cost of living crisis may have had. Scottish Labour welcomes the cost to families of imprisonment and release report. We look forward to hearing what action the government will take to address the problems that it correctly diagnoses.
Thank you, Mr. Mara. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Richard Leonard. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate my colleague Rona Mackay on bringing this debate to the Chamber and for her continued work to promote fair, progressive approach to prison policy and to Scotland's justice system. I also thank the charity Families Outside for all the work that they do to support families impacted by imprisonment. In my contribution this evening, I'll touch on the report from Families Outside, and will also touch on the work of Prisoners Abroad, which is another charity who support the families of those from the UK who are serving sentences in other countries. Presiding Officer, the evidence is clear. The cost to families of imprisonment is stark. Here are a few key statistics for families here in Scotland. For those held in remand, the average distance travelled per visit by families was 74 miles and the cost £70 a month. And £60 per month was spent on food snacks at visits and £100 into the personal account and £55 on other costs. And Rona Mackay has mentioned the food costs on visits as well. And for example, it costs £1 to purchase a Galaxy chocolate bar from the vending machine in Parliament. But at Polmont, it costs £2.50 for the same chocolate bar. So, and the profits going direct to the private vending machine company. Why are the prices in Parliament and the prices in prison so different? I was interested to find that fact out, actually. So I'm wondering, is it just because it's a captive audience? Is it just for pure profit? Additionally, if a person is sentenced, the cost increases significantly compared to remand. And Rona Mackay has outlined some of these costs as well. Again, the average distance, if somebody is in prison that's serving 6 years, that was the average they looked at. The family travelled twice a month for the visit. The average distance was 106 miles for a return journey, costing £77 a month on travel and £36 on supplemental snacks, £88 in the personal account and £75 on other costs. So these costs are actually pretty significant. The median total spent per month was £180 a month, around a third of the household income, and £2,160 per year supporting the person in prison. And I know Rona Mackay has mentioned that already, but it is worth reiterating. The financial costs are significant, and also we need to, of course, reflect on the emotional impacts of having a family member in prison as well. There are clear ways to improve this, though. Families Outside reported that they would like toiletries, prison clothes and footwear to be free, for the telephone calls and the canteen to be cheaper, and for the prisoner wages to be improved for the in-person work that they carry out. This would allow those in prison to be more self-sufficient in terms of not total reliance on the family, many who are impacted already by increased costs and, of course, the cost of living crisis as well. As the Scottish Government continues to move Scotland's justice system to a more progressive system, which focuses on prevention, education, rehabilitation, I ask the Minister to seriously consider these recommendations and outline the Scottish Government's position on them. And turning to families with prisoners abroad, this is my final point, Presiding Officer. There are 750 people from the UK in prison abroad. 196 are being held in the United States in federal or state prison. The cost to families visiting family members abroad, particularly in the United States, is in excess of £2,500 per visit. This includes airfare, insurance, car hire, accommodation, food as well, and the cost of paying for additional snacks, canteen and toiletries. So in the USA, the same issues are reflected as what we are seeing in Scotland with the additional cost. Prisons Abroad, the UK-wide charity supporting families of prisoners abroad, have called on the UK Foreign Office to consider the feasibility of creating a grant scheme which could allow family members to visit family in prisons abroad. So I ask the Minister whether this is something that could be considered, or could you even raise it with the UK Government, as we know how vital it is for the welfare of families and for those in prison to maintain family contact. So in closing, Presiding Officer, there are many complex issues associated with prisoners and families, and I have just highlighted a few, so I look forward to the Minister's response. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call on Richard Leonard to be followed by Audrey Nicol. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Rona Mackay for bringing this extremely important debate to Parliament, and if I may say so, for making one of the most thoughtful opening speeches in a member's debate I've heard for a very long time. It's right that we reflect on the human cost of imprisonment, the anguish and the hardship of families outside, the impact on children, but on parents, on aunties, uncles, cousins, brothers, sisters, the wider family network too. Their voices must be listened to and heard. All those worlds turned upside down, the devastating toll that it can take. I want to focus on the toll that one family has faced, the ultimate toll. I speak of the family of Alan Marshall. Anyone who has met Alan Marshall's loving family, as I have been privileged to do, or has witnessed from afar their denial of justice, will welcome the Lord Advocate's announcement just this morning that on her instruction, his death in custody back in 2015 will at last be the subject of a police investigation. It's an investigation that may lead to the prosecution of the Scottish Prison Service for corporate homicide. We cannot, of course, prejudge that outcome. There is a live police inquiry, but what we do know is this. Alan Marshall was just 30 years old. He had two young children, a son and a daughter. He was in Stockton prison, not convicted, but on remand. On remand for breach of the peace and for non-payment of fines. We know as well, 13 prison officers held him down, or to use the jargon, restrained and controlled him. They did it with such force that a fatal accident inquiry concluded that his death was, and I quote, entirely preventable. And that's why today's decision by the Lord Advocate is welcome. It's a completely unprecedented move that may end up with the Scottish Prison Service being held corporately responsible. But it begs the question whether it was right that prison officers who were described by the fatal accident inquiry sheriff as, I quote, mutually dishonest, should have been granted immunity in the first place. And there are other questions which arise from this case which have a wider resonance in tonight's debate. Like, why did the Scottish Prison Service believe it could just ignore three of the 13 recommendations of the fatal accident inquiry, including the recommendation?
Mr. Leonard, I don't wish to be unduly restrictive, but the member will realise that we do have a motion in front of us, and I'm sure the member would wish to bring it back. As important as the issues that he has raised are, he would wish to bring the issues back to the actual details of the motion. Thank you.
Well, Presiding Officer, Rona Mackay spoke about paying the price. This is one family's story.
Indeed, and I do accept that, and that's why I have given the member lassitude, but I do think focusing on the family of the individual Mr. Leonard had referred to would perhaps be of more relevance now in his last minute in the debate. Thank you.
Okay. Well, let me finish with just two final points, if I may, Presiding Officer. Because one of the other questions that arises is why was the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Humza Yousaf, prepared to sanction the Scottish Prison Service taking out an interdict to censor the Free Press and stop the Sunday Mail reaching the newsstands
because it was running
Alan Marshall's story?
Mr. Leonard, I have made it quite clear that we need to address the motion. If the member wishes to bring a different debate at a different time, that is absolutely up to the member, but we are dealing with this debate. Please bring it back to the family of the individual he is referring to. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, tonight we consider the price paid by all families with loved ones in prison. And tonight, Alan Marshall's family believe they are one step closer in their fight for justice. Our thoughts are with them all. Our fight for justice and for a better world than this carries on.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call on the Minister, Elena Whittam, to respond to the debate. I don't call on the Minister. I'm off my stride. I call on Audrey Nicol to make her contribution. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been a long day. Thank you. I'm very grateful to Rona Mackay for bringing this debate forward today on an issue I know that she is passionate about, as demonstrated by her convenership of the cross-party groups on women, families and justice and men's violence against women and girls. And as we've already heard, Families Outside is for many a lifeline organisation that supports families navigate the challenges arising for a loved one, from a loved one serving a prison sentence. And I commend the detailed research and analysis set out in their report, The Cost to Families of Imprisonment and Release. And it outlines the ripple effect of financial, emotional, mental and physical harm experienced by families, and in particular single women, on low incomes affected by imprisonment. So today I'd like to focus on release, an issue that both Rona Mackay and Michael Mara referenced in their contributions, and that has been considered recently by the Criminal Justice Committee during its work on the Bail and Release from Custody Bill that seeks to give greater focus to rehabilitation and reintegration of individuals leaving custody. And in their report, Families Outside narrate the challenges of the financial cost of someone leaving prison, anything from £30 to £1,000 a month. Women interviewed for the study felt very much left to get on with it, describing the first 2 months following release as the most stressful and costly, often at a time when money is short due to benefits not yet being in place. Meeting and taking someone home from prison can incur significant cost. One woman had to travel the day before, reside overnight in a hotel, before travelling home, costing around a quarter of her monthly budget. And women spoke of the cost of basic items such as a kettle, a TV, curtains, where a family member was moving into new accommodation, having lost their previous home. Two interviewees were unaware of the grants available within the Scottish Welfare Fund. One interviewee spoke of the cost of protecting a friend from returning to the area where she was likely to resume drug use, covering costs of clothing and food until her benefits were set up and keeping on the heating during the day. And one mother spoke of the pressure of taking time off work, having to take time off to settle her son in his flat, and this is by no means an unusual scenario. Presiding Officer, during its scrutiny of the Bail and Release from Custody Bill, the Criminal Justice Committee heard from Professor Fergus McNeill, who referred to research undertaken by the University of Glasgow on post-prison integration and the need to address key facets including housing, employment, skills development, social integration and political participation. And the conclusions set out by Families Outside add to this analysis, recognising the added impact of austerity, service cuts, the pandemic and now the cost of living on families affected by prison. And the report sets out ideas for development around release, including reinstating through care and facilitating making benefits claims and engagement with support services well in advance of release. And indeed, on a recent visit to HMP Grampian, the Governor there, Mike Hebden, reflected that planning for release should begin the day that someone enters prison. So the ideas set out by Families Outside align with much of the evidence heard by the Criminal Justice Committee, and I very much hope will inform a robust and meaningful response from the Scottish Government and lead to positive change in policy and practice so that release from prison is no longer a burden, rather it is a starting point for all families in Scotland. So once again, my thanks to Rona Mackay for bringing this motion forward this afternoon.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. And I now call on the Minister, Elena Whittam, to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I also would like to thank Rona Mackay for bringing this important issue to the Chamber today. The impact of imprisonment on families is, as Families Outside report makes clear, significant and often unseen. That makes it all the more essential that these issues are openly discussed and debated. This isn't someone else's problem. We all have a responsibility to listen to these families and to take action. I would also like to take this opportunity to acknowledge, as others have done, the vital work that Families Outside do. I know they are a lifeline to many families affected by imprisonment. 20 years ago, when I worked supporting young people at risk of homelessness, many facing addiction issues, experience of care, childhood trauma, oftentimes it felt like I was on my own, trying to hold everything together when one of my young folk was in prison. And it's extremely exhausting for everyone, not least their families. The report covers a number of extremely important issues, and I can't do them all justice in the time I have, but I'd like to focus on some key points. Firstly, the report emphasises the negative impact on imprisonment and calls for the use of prison to be truly a last resort. And this government has been clear that whilst prison will always be necessary for those who pose a risk of serious harm, we need to look again at how custody is used in a modern and progressive Scotland. There is no reason why we should have the highest imprisonment rate in Western Europe. We know that short periods of imprisonment, including on remand, do not address the underlying causes of offending or support rehabilitation. And I think it's important just to take a second to understand that many of those people who are in prison are often victims of criminal acts. So whilst they may be offenders, they are indeed victims. And we know that many people in contact with the justice system have experienced multiple and severe disadvantage. We should not use imprisonment to address these wider societal harms. And as this report highlights, the impact on the children and families of people in custody can be devastating and wide-ranging. That is why we're taking action to shift the balance towards greater use of community-based interventions, which we know are more effective than short-term imprisonment at reducing reoffending. That includes continued investment in community justice services. In 2023-24, the Scottish Government will invest a total of £134 million in community justice services. That includes £123 million to local authorities to support the delivery of community-based sentences and interventions, including alternatives to remand. And this is not by any means soft justice. It can be transformative justice at the heart of our communities. We have also introduced legislation, the Bail and Release from Custody Bill, which members have already referenced this evening, which will be shortly debated in this chamber at stage one. That bill focuses on two of the key issues raised in this report, the impact of remand and improving support for people leaving prison. Remand removes people from their families, their homes, their jobs, their communities. And we must remember that these are mostly people who have been accused of an offence and have not been convicted of any crime. The bill seeks to refocus how remand is used so that custody is reserved for those who pose a risk to public safety or the delivery of justice. The bill also seeks to improve the pre-release planning and support provided to people leaving prison to enable their successful reintegration. We know that holistic, well-planned support for people leaving prison can reduce their risk of reoffending and improve their outcomes, and the provisions within this bill are intended to support this. This is alongside ongoing investment in national third sector through care services. As has been referenced tonight, through care we know is a hugely important thing. We need to provide that one-to-one support for people leaving prison. This investment currently totals £3.7 million a year. And I know firsthand from my work in homelessness services just how crucial the support is at the time that someone is liberated. And our third sector partners are providing that critical lifeline. And we must strive to ensure supports are in place in advance of someone leaving prison. And why embedding the SHORE standards, which is the Sustainable Housing on Release for Everyone standards across all areas, is important via local authorities' rapid rehousing transition plans. The report also highlights the importance of specific financial and emotional supports for families of people in prison. That includes the critical role that prison visitor centres play. The Scottish Government has provided funding, currently up to £800,000 a year since 2016-17, to support the development of PVCs across Scotland. And I'm delighted that there are now 12 of these centres. And we remain committed to maintaining funding for prisoner visitor centres in 2023-24. And I would like to take this opportunity to say a huge well done to East Ayrshire's Recovery Enterprises, who have been providing the PVC service at HMP Kilmarnock since January, and I know the team personally and I know how committed they are to supporting folk during difficult times and their families. As highlighted in the report, the Scottish Welfare Fund can be an essential source of support. The fund established in 2013 is administered by local authorities and provides two forms of discretionary awards, a crisis grant and a community care grant. The community care grants can be awarded to prisoners leaving to help them establish or maintain a settled home in the community, and this is invaluable support, especially when someone's previous tenancy has been lost and belongings have been cleared. They can also provide to family members and to assist in the care of an individual who has been released from prison on a temporary release. And we also must recognise the gendered nature of how supporting a family member in prison, especially during a cost of living crisis. Women bear the cost, and income maximisation is vital, so we must support those families to actually ensure that they're receiving all support that they can. I would like to highlight the work of the Scottish Prison Service in supporting family contact and mitigating the impact of the cost of living crisis for prisoners and their families. And that does include trying to keep prices within the prison canteens at a minimum and reviewing the application of prisoner wage policy. And whilst the vending machines in prisons are a matter for the SPS, I hope they have heard Emma Harper's call to ensure pricing is reasonable. I think the example she gave today is quite a stark one. The SPS are also committed to making visits as family-friendly as possible. This may look different in each establishment, but includes reviewing visiting timetables in light of family feedback, having family days and supporting virtual visits where appropriate. And the SPS is currently revising their family strategy informed by active consultation with prisoners and their families. And that strategy aims to support and encourage those in SPS's care to play an active role in building strong and stable families. I would just like to take a second as well to talk about the stark statistic that Colette Stevenson told us earlier. When we think about the number of children who are in families where there's divorce, it's actually outnumbered by the number of children who are experiencing the trauma of having a family member in prison. And also would like to reassure her that the Scottish Government and SPS are actively working with Timpsons and other employers to figure out how we can best support them to give people the opportunity to thrive and bring them opportunities. Michael Mara, I would like to assure you that we have established a cross-portfolio ministerial working group to explore the urgent issues that he brought to the table tonight. But I would be really happy to meet with you in a one-to-one to discuss all of that, because you brought some really important points to the chamber. And also, just would like to say to Richard Leonard, I would like to take the opportunity to recognise Alan Marshall's family and their stoic and steadfast seek of justice for him. But I can't comment any further at the moment, you will understand, due to the ongoing issues at hand. I would like to say to everybody today that's out there who has a family member in prison, we have heard your voices loud and clear through this report. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.